Harper Audio presents Midnight in Ruby Bayou by Elizabeth Lowell, performed by Robin Rowan. Copyright 2000 by Two of a Kind Incorporated. Production copyright 2009 by HarperCollins Publishers. Prologue. St. Petersburg, January. The public areas were above the thieves. Buildings 3 and 4 stories high that held centuries of art and artifacts collected by rulers whose whim was the very breath of life for their subjects. There was room after room filled with extraordinary sculptures, ancient icons and immense tapestries, paintings to make angels weep and saints envious, quantities of gold and silver and gemstones beyond the ability of even man's deepest avarice to comprehend. In the darkest hours of the early January night, there was only time and the scrape of guards' worn boots over marble that had once known only the polished arrogance of royalty. The smallest sounds echoed down the long, magnificent corridors with their gilt and vaulted ceilings, supported by columns as tall as ancient gods. Even the hundreds of public rooms weren't enough to display all 3 million items in the treasure trove. The lesser items, or those out of fashion at the moment, were stored in basement warrens, where gleaming marble gave way to crumbling plaster and rat-gnawed wood. Dust lay like dirty snow on every surface. The bureaucrats who had once listed and catalogued the imperial collections were long gone, dismissed by a civilian government that could barely keep its soldiers in bullets. 3 women and 2 men moved briskly down the narrow subterranean hallways. Caught in the glow of flashlights, human breath came out in white bursts. In front of the museum, the River Neva was frozen. So was everything else in St. Petersburg that couldn't afford or steal electricity. Away from the public areas where foreign diplomats, dignitaries, and tourists gaped at royal treasures, the buildings were in disrepair. The world-class pieces of art, the Rubenses and Da Vincis and Rembrandts, were well-maintained. The rest of the Tsar's treasures had to be as hardy as the Russian people themselves to survive. One of the thieves unlocked a large room and flipped on the switch by the door. Nothing happened. Someone cursed, but no one was surprised. Everyone in the city stole light bulbs for their own use. Using a flashlight held by her partner, the dark-haired woman went to work on a huge decades-old safe. The tumblers were bulky. The door squealed like a dying pig when she opened it. She was not worried by the metallic scream. Even if the guards above heard it, they would keep on making their rounds through warm, empty halls and imperial rooms. The guards weren't paid well enough to investigate odd sounds. No smart urban citizen poked around in the dark looking for trouble. Enough came in the normal course of life. Working in whispers, the thieves began pulling open lockers and drawers. Occasionally, someone would grunt or draw in a breath at a particularly spectacular piece of jewelry. If their hands lingered, the dark-haired woman spoke curtly. She had her orders. Take only the modest pieces, the forgotten ones. The nameless baubles that were uninspired gifts from long-dead aristocrats or merchants or foreign officials seeking favor with the czars. These were the pieces that were listed on royal inventories as brooch, pearls with red center stone, or stomacher, blue stones with diamond surrounds. None of these pieces were valued enough to be documented in the imperial portraits upstairs. None of them appeared in photographs of imperial jewelry. They were blessedly anonymous. But ah, the temptation to take one of the less modest, more dangerous pieces. The itch to hold an emerald as big as a hen's egg, to feel 200 carats of sapphire set in a medieval buckle, to slip a handful of diamond bracelets into a pocket, to ease a 20-carat ruby ring into the hidden compartment behind your belt. It had happened more than once in the past. A swift movement beyond the reach of the flashlight, the sudden weight of wealth tucked against a thigh or belly. Amid all the kilos of glitter, who would miss an ounce or two? It happened again tonight. One of the men was methodically stealing every fifth piece of jewelry that lay tangled in a long drawer. When he was finished, he opened another drawer. This one was orderly, with each piece numbered, tagged, and set in its own niche.
"Not that one, shithead," hissed the woman. "Can you not see the value is too much?"
He could see, and he could barely breathe. The slightest touch of light had set part of the drawer ablaze. A ruby as big as an idol's eye lay inside. There were other rubies in the necklace, magnificent rubies. But next to the centerpiece, they faded into insignificance. Surrounded by pearls like snow around fire, the huge ruby pendant shimmered and cast its ancient spell of wealth and danger. Muttering, he moved to close the drawer. It stuck, or appeared to. He tucked the flashlight under his arm, aiming the light away from the jewelry. Then he jiggled and shoved and yanked until the drawer was closed, and the necklace was deep in a concealed pocket in his pants. The first in a long, deadly row of dominoes began to fall. Chapter 1. Seattle, February. Owen Walker lived in a bare-bones efficiency apartment overlooking Pioneer Square, one of Seattle's less upscale tourist attractions. The front door was unimpressive. No happy barks or impatient kitty yowls greeted Walker's approaching footsteps. The closest thing he had to a pet was the refrigerator mold that grew while he was overseas on assignment for Donovan International. Lately, that had been most of the time. Other than installing a new, stronger deadbolt when he took over the apartment, Walker had spent little effort making the place into an urban cocoon. The bed was big enough for his 6-foot frame. It also served as a couch to stretch out on and watch TV if he was home long enough to get involved in the misfortunes of the Seahawks or the Mariners or the Sonics. Recently, he had been lucky to keep up with his own problems, much less those of the teams whose members were traded around faster than hot gossip. Today hadn't been any different. Even the problems had problems. The latest one was the assignment Archer Donovan had dropped on him this afternoon.
"See if the rubies Davis Montague sent Faith match any on the international hot list. I don't want my sister's reputation as a designer ruined by using stolen goods. Montague sent what she described as 14 superior rubies, between 1 and 4 carats. They're loose now, but could have been part of a single piece of jewelry."
Since Archer didn't want his little sister to know that he was sticking his nose in her business without her invitation, Walker didn't have the actual rubies to work with. All he had was a verbal description. Walker had spent the past 4 hours on Donovan International's phones with various global cops. He hadn't accomplished anything but to make his injured leg stiffen up. So far, the rubies had come up clean. He had the calloused ear to prove it. Tonight, he would check them out on the internet. But first, food. Automatically, he threw the locks on the door behind him, hung his cane over the doorknob, and limped to the refrigerator to see if anything looked like a late lunch or an early dinner. Whichever. His body still wasn't certain which continent it was on, despite the clean black slacks, crisp dark blue shirt that matched his eyes, and close-cut black beard. He felt like something the cat had dragged in, and the rat refused to eat. Jet lag, or the beating that some eager Afghani bandits had given him last week, made him feel every one of his 30-odd years like a separate insult. Thoughts of the near-disastrous Afghanistan trip fled when the smell of garlic sausage from last night's takeout Italian hit him in a wave. After the second breath, he decided that the sausage wasn't from last night, more like 3 nights ago. Or 4, maybe 5. He'd had a real craving for Italian when he returned from Afghanistan, but he hadn't wanted to gimp through Pike Place Market looking for fresh ingredients. Instead, he had eaten way too much takeout food since he had climbed stiffly down the steps from the company plane into the Pacific Northwest's February gloom. Cautiously, he opened the lid of the nearest leftover box. Nothing looked green, and there probably wasn't enough left to poison him anyway.
With a mental shrug, he put the sagging box in the microwave and nuked it. While invisible energy tried to breathe new life into old takeout, he decided to call the meal an early supper. For that, he could open one of the long-necked beer bottles that had waited patiently during his absence. By the time the microwave cheeped, he was on the internet, requesting a global search for stolen loose rubies bigger than 1 carat or for stolen jewelry that contained 14 rubies of more than a carat. While the computer chewed on his request, he walked back to his pocket-sized kitchen, opened the microwave, and grabbed a fork from a nearby drawer. He took his first bite of lukewarm supper on the way to the computer. The pasta had the texture and taste of rubber bands, but the sausage was still spicy enough to make his mouth tingle. He had eaten much worse food and been glad to get it, both as a boy and more recently, when he had shared campfires and rations with Afghani miners. Between bites, he scrolled through a list of stolen rubies that had been posted by everyone from maiden aunts to Interpol. Some offered rewards, no questions asked. Others offered a finder's fee, also no questions asked. Law enforcement organizations of various kinds offered telephone numbers and the opportunity to be a good citizen. Smaller rubies were missing, but most of them were described as having a modern cut. Some were said to be family heirlooms, but in Walker's experience, that could mean anything from 1550 to 1950. It was possible that the Montague rubies Faith Donovan was designing into a necklace had come from one or more of the long, long list of stolen heirlooms, but he doubted it. The dates on the postings went from last week to 30 years ago and originated from 23 separate countries. None of the lists mentioned 14 superior rubies, set or loose, that ranged upward from 1 carat. So much for work. On to private pleasures. Walker scraped the last of the pungent sauce from the carton, took a drink of beer, and went to another website, one he often visited. This one was an international clearinghouse for sales of gems and jewelry of all kinds. As he did every night that he was near a computer, he entered a request for rubies that were carved or inscribed in some way. 42 entries came back. He scrolled through them quickly. Most were only a few steps above what a tourist would find in a squalid Thai alley. The carvings were as lackluster as the stones were dubious. He paused over a good quality ruby that had a laughing Buddha etched on the long flat table. After a moment, he scrolled on again. He had a similar and better gem in his collection. Walker stopped when he found an exquisite 4-carat stone with a heart carved on one side and a cross on the other. It was presumed to be from one of the Crusades. Wistfully, he stared at the gem. If it looked half as good under a microscope as it looked on the screen, the ruby would make a splendid addition to his personal collection. He would put in a bid if the stone didn't cost an arm and a leg. It did. The price tag had 10 too many. 2, actually.
"Same shit, different day," he muttered.
3 months in Afghanistan hadn't changed much except the way he walked, and that was only temporary. He went back to looking at less costly goods. Nothing he saw interested him. Grimacing, Walker shut down his computer and looked around for something to do in the hours before he slept and tried not to dream of gun butts smashing his head. Several books beckoned, but his brain was still too fuzzy from adjusting to Seattle's time zone to be much use on his latest project. A kind of do-it-yourself tour through the German language, compliments of a German book on rare gems and gem carving. Idly, he considered scanning the book into his computer, running it through all 9 of his translation programs, and comparing the results. The thought brought a grin to his mouth. The last time he had done that, with an article on Thailand's leading gem traders, he and Archer and Kyle Donovan had laughed themselves blind at the results. That was when Walker had begun teaching himself German, complete with West Texas rhythms on top of his South Carolina boyhood drawl. He had just begun making real progress on reading the language when Donovan International had sent him to Afghanistan to survey the possibilities of buying into the ruby trade there. Walker could speak Afghani, but couldn't read it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.